Welcome back to Felony Spectator. I am your host, Heather, and today we're not going to do one of our full true crime episodes. We're just going to do a discussion. This one is about none other than the documentary, The Murder of Laci Peterson, that I watched on Prime. I'm going to try and stick with what I saw in this documentary. There are others out there. There's so many things that you can find out there about Scott and Laci Peterson. It was so highly publicized, and one that always sort of just stuck in my mind because I feel like it's still unsolved, even though I know Scott is actually in jail. So I'm not going to review it. I just want to talk about it because this particular documentary sort of changed my mind on the whole thing. I'm sure most of you know the case Scott Peterson, who was found guilty of killing his pregnant wife on Christmas Day. Laci's headless torso would wash up in the San Francisco Bay, as did the little body of their unborn son, Connor. And up until I watched this documentary on Prime, I was pretty sure that Scott was guilty in some sort of capacity. However, I don't think he should have been sentenced to death, especially now that I've seen this documentary. Okay, let's discuss it and leave me a comment if you think that I'm way off or just give me your opinion. This whole case is really just centered around the fact that Scott was cheating on his wife and lied a lot. Like a lot. He is a pathological liar, and we all know that, but I also don't think he was very smart. He must be charming in real life, maybe, but I don't think he was very smart, and I don't think he was smart enough to pull this off without leaving any physical evidence behind. In this documentary, there isn't any evidence that screamed, he did it. No murder weapon, no DNA evidence, no blood, no bodily fluids anywhere. Nothing was found in his home. Nothing was found in his place of employment. Nothing was found in his truck or even in his boat, which he allegedly used to dump her body. Everything just seemed to be circumstantial or theory-based. The best evidence the prosecution had was two strands of hair found on some small pliers. The defense argued there wasn't a follicle attached to the hair, so only mitochondrial DNA was done, which can't show you that it was 100% a match. The closest it can get is that the hair is either Laci or someone in Laci's family, and I believe it's specifically the maternal side. In the show, they point out that the hair wasn't compared to any hair found on the torso. And maybe that's not important to compare, but you would think it might be. I don't know. I think that comparing her hair would confirm 100% that it was her. It doesn't point out that Scott killed her or used them on her while he killed her. There would be blood on them, or you would think some kind of bodily fluid. I don't know. What were the pliers even used for? The documentary did talk about the jurors a lot, which I think is important here because I've heard that if you go to court for murder, and I hope none of you do, to always try and get a trial by judge, not jury, because humans are too emotional. It's very hard for us to separate our opinions with facts or leave our own morals at the door. And a judge is desensitized by all that stuff and more logical, and they're going to stick with just the facts. With that said, I do not think that Scott got the right to an impartial jury in this case. The drama that unfolded during the trial should have led the judge to put a trial on pause, or maybe even just overhaul the jury completely. There might have been an illusion that the jurors were being dealt with, but there might have been an illusion that the jurors were being dealt with. For example, there was a juror who got kicked off for saying hi or brief small talk to Laci's brother while they were entering the courts. They were going through the metal detector and it was very brief and quick. And he was just removed from the jury for being polite. Another juror was kicked off because she researched the phishing information that Scott claimed to use, and the jurors are specifically asked not to do any outside research at all. And then you have other jurors who were at the bar in public discussing the case, and they didn't get kicked off. And then along comes Strawberry Shortcake, the girl with the really long, long red hair, who comes in with a fire under her ass. And she also committed misconduct by not disclosing her prior involvement with other legal proceedings. She wouldn't have been able to be eligible if she had told the truth. She played a big part of convincing the jury that he was guilty. She admits that there was never any way that she was going to back down. And there was another juror who admitted that it was the photo of Lacey's torso that made her agree on the death penalty. But that, to me, is emotion, not evidence. A photo of a body made you so upset. So without real evidence, you decide to end someone else's life? Jurors are supposed to stick to 100% proven evidence. So why were some people kicked off for small things, and why were other people not kicked off for bigger things? The documentary, and pretty much anything that you read, talks about how the media played such a big part in convincing the general public that he was guilty. Even though jurors aren't supposed to research or watch the news, how can you prove that they didn't know prior information beforehand? It was such a huge case and was in the media long before that he was actually arrested. They also had to walk past large crowds, huge crowds, every single morning of these people screaming and protesting about how guilty he was. How could you not be influenced by that? I mean, Justin, who was kicked off for saying hi, actually got death threats because he admitted on TV that Scott could be innocent. Now, Scott is douchey. He's 100% a liar, and he's the type of person who lies so much that he needs to lie about his lies. He got to the point where he couldn't even get his story straight. He obviously lies to avoid confrontation, basically saying things that he thinks people will want to hear, even though it's not true. I mean, he even lied to Diane Sawyer and then called ABC News that night and told them that it was all a lie. ABC released the interview anyways, and I think people actually think it's real and pick him apart or analyze his body language. If you Google it, watch it, and just know that it's completely made up. Scott was cheating on his wife, so he was obviously in the habit of lying, and lying was not a new thing for him. He had lots of practice. And maybe that's why he seemed to be so unemotional. Like, how could you have an emotional attachment to anything if you're lying about everything at the same time? It's also possible that maybe he just isn't an emotional person. With that said, that was his biggest downfall. He was a liar who cheated on his pregnant wife, and people hated him. And I have dated liars. I mean, if I could lock them all up to prevent other women from getting hurt, that would be fantastic. Scott obviously lies to Amber Frey about all kinds of stuff. Now, she was the mistress, so yeah, she's gonna be lied to. His biggest lie to her was that Lacey was already dead. He backpedals, though. He told Amber that he was married before, but he lost his wife, implying that she was already dead. And it was his first Christmas alone. That's a huge lie. And that lie is really what made a lot of people question if this was a premeditated murder. While there is no solid proof that he was actually going to leave Lacey and be with Amber, it just doesn't make him look good. He doesn't really have an explanation for that particular lie either, just that there was different types of loss, now implying that she wasn't dead, but his loss meant something emotionally, not physically. And I don't know. That seems a little bit weird. His second biggest lie to Amber was that he says he was traveling in Europe. Again, why? Maybe we can assume that it's because it was Christmas and he knew he wouldn't be able to see Amber due to seeing family gatherings and doing all that Christmassy stuff. So maybe he just did one big lie to excuse his absence versus a bunch of smaller lies. What was unsettling was that he sounded happy in those phone calls and like he was having fun, all the while his wife was missing. And those phone call recordings really sounded creepy because he was acting like he was a happy boyfriend to Amber. During Lacey's vigil, he pretended to be at the Eiffel Tower. And you would think at some point he would think, whoa, I have to stop lying because I'm gonna get in trouble. Scott only knew Lacey for about a month, so to me that isn't convincing either that he was going to just throw his life away and move in with his mistress. I think most cheaters use a second person more of an outlet for something that's missing in their marriage, but he had a decent marriage and he had such a good relationship with his in-laws too. I think Amber was more of a booty call or someone to have fun with while Lacey was grumpy and pregnant. Or maybe it was just his last hurrah before the baby comes. So we know Scott's a liar and a cheater. I mean, if you're cheating, then you're a liar. But loads of people cheat without killing their spouses. But if you're cheating and your spouse ends up dead, then you're in trouble. Another reason not to cheat. Now let's talk about the boat situation. Apparently he lied about that too, and nobody even knew he had a boat. Going back to what I said about Scott lying not to get in trouble, it's very possible that he didn't tell Laci or anyone because he didn't want to get in trouble. Maybe Laci would have been pissed that he spent money on a boat right before their baby was born. That would explain also why he said he was going golfing, because had he said he was going fishing, it wouldn't have made sense, being that nobody knew that he had a boat. And people also wondered why he fished on Christmas morning. To me, that's not totally uncommon, especially where I live. I mean, my family has fished Christmas Eve before, and I mean, people do also like to take a little bit of quiet time before big dinners or family functions just to recharge. And Laci's own stepdad was fishing that morning. Yes, Laci was pregnant, and I have heard people say, why would you leave your pregnant wife alone on Christmas who was pregnant? But her due date wasn't until February, so it's not like she was about to go into labor that day. And personally, to me, that's not totally suspicious. Fun fact, my husband went fishing the day I went into labor, so I can't really judge someone for wanting to go fishing. Let's talk about the actual boat. So it was only a 14-foot aluminum boat. It's not fancy, it's small and very tippy. We used to own one and they are definitely super tippy. If one of us wanted to move around, the other would need to counterbalance our weight to keep the boat stable. And we brought our dog on the boat once or twice and it was absolutely sketchy. We'd be scrambling to counter his weight when he wanted to move around. So I sort of do believe that it would have been very, very difficult to dump Laci's body over the side of a boat, especially if there were also concrete anchors attached to her limbs, which the prosecution assumed. Now, I don't know what the water's like in the bay, but if there's any waves, like, I don't know, I find it very hard to believe that that's how he got rid of the body. The documentary also said there was a video of them trying to reenact the boat situation, but for some reason that wasn't shown in court. And that definitely could have convinced jurors that he didn't do it. That got me thinking that maybe he hired someone to kill Laci, and then he went to go fishing in the bay, but was really just there to see the body being dumped. That wasn't in the documentary. That's just something I thought could possibly happen. But perhaps those men who robbed the house across the street were hired hitmen. I don't know. Another theory. Anyway, back to the boat. There are photos of the boat, and you can clearly see that this boat was not cleaned out before the police got it on their search warrant. You would think that there would be more evidence of a body. This boat was new to Scott, and apparently he never did a test run on it, or even knew how to use it, really. So that, to me, seems pretty ballsy if you were dumping a body in broad daylight. You think he would need a little more experience. And the robbery is also intriguing, because if Laci had confronted these men after she walked the dogs, then there is a huge possibility that Scott wasn't the one who killed her. There was a recorded phone call of an inmate and his brother in which the brother told the inmate about a burglary and Laci confronting them. But somehow this tape is missing, and that would also prove that Laci was alive while Scott was out fishing. In the timeline, according to the documentary, Scott left the house just after 9:30 a.m. So in theory, he would have actually loaded Laci into his truck in broad daylight. And then he would go to his office and grab the boat, do some internetting, and then take her to the marina, remove her from the truck, place her in the boat again in broad daylight, drive through the marina without being seen, and dispose her on a very tippy boat. I don't know if that even makes sense. And why Christmas? Like, they would have had plans to see family. Like, even Boxing Day would have been better. The timing just seems a little odd to me. And obviously her family would know and go crazy that she disappeared on Christmas. I feel like if it was another day, he could have bought himself a little more time. Then there is the timing of Laci walking her dog. Many people reported seeing her. Now, we can assume that some of them probably were off on their timing and some probably didn't even see her at all. But the fact was there were so many witnesses and nobody was followed up on. Laci's family admits that they also found it odd that Laci was even walking the dog, because apparently she was very tired and very uncomfortable from being pregnant. But there are over 14 sightings of a pregnant woman and a dog that were never followed up on. A mailman also claimed that the dog, Mackenzie, wasn't in the yard between 10:45 and 10:50. He actually scans the mail, so he has timestamps, which are very accurate. There was also another lady who put the dog in the yard at 10:18, which was proven by receipts. So both people are very credible, and that means there is about 20-ish minutes where the dog got out a second time. So this is what makes me question the entire case, and this is my reasonable doubt, because Scott wasn't home during all of that time. He logged into his computer before taking the boat out, and he has a receipt from the marina, so there is evidence of him not being home. Then the bodies of Connor and Laci washed up, which led to Scott's arrest. Strangely, the baby, who was unborn, had his ear taped forward, and there was tape around his body as well. And this tape could have tangled up around him from the ocean, but how was his ear taped forward? Prosecutors think that it was electrical tape, but the defense thinks it's kelp. But how does kelp firmly hold your ear forward? I don't know. That doesn't make sense to me. And apparently it was rectangular and quite squared off, which would have been odd if it was kelp. But that evidence is also now nowhere to be found. Laci's pants that washed up were also a different color than the ones that everyone thought she was wearing. Scott remembers her wearing black pants. The witnesses say that she was in black pants, but it was actually tan pants that washed up. So she must have changed when she got home from walking the dog, or they weren't her pants. And Scott's actions when he got home do seem strange. I mean, he took a shower, did a load of laundry of just his clothes, and didn't call Laci's mom until around 5:30. He just assumed she was at her mom's house, even though her car was there at home. He's just so self-absorbed and selfish that he didn't care to figure out where his pregnant wife was. I'd like to think that if it was my husband and he came home, whether I was pregnant or not, and I wasn't home, that he would call me or text me or try a little harder. The theory is that maybe he did get all wet and dirty from dumping Laci from a tippy boat, and that's why he needed to shower and do his laundry. There were other strange inconsistencies, but the big evidence presented in court had holes and wasn't hard evidence either. The police are pretty convinced that he's the guy, so maybe they had even more evidence that didn't make it to court. Sometimes the public are not privy to that information, but at the end of the day, we're supposed to look at someone as innocent until proven guilty. And that's why someone like Casey Anthony wasn't convicted in killing her daughter. And in my opinion, there was way more evidence pointing at her, but there was reasonable doubt. And there wasn't any evidence to 100% prove that she did it. So her jury didn't convict her. And I think in Scott's case, there's also reasonable doubt and nothing to 100% point to him either. But his jurors did convict him. And that just proves that people are unreliable. In a way, I sort of hope that Scott is responsible so that we know he is where he needs to be. His death penalty conviction did get overturned, and a new trial is being discussed or appealed based on jury misconduct. And I guess that's happening this year. If you haven't watched this documentary, I encourage you to do so because it might just make you doubt his conviction. Start Googling this. There is a huge rabbit hole. There are Facebook groups, websites devoted to his convictions or guilt, conspiracy theories, confessions from other people. The Ed Edwards confession is the most interesting. And there's also a Facebook page called Scott Peterson Appeal, and there's a lot of stuff discussed there as well. They also have an explanation as to why there was so much cash in Scott's car, and why he changed his appearance, and why his brother's ID was in the car. And maybe his family's lying for Scott, but it definitely gives you something to think about. Now, this case is so controversial. I would love to hear what you think. Please leave me a comment. I would love to know. Thanks again for joining me here at Felony Spectator. Please hit subscribe so you don't miss another episode. Bye.